Thank you, Mr. Toastmaster. Hello, fellow Toastmasters. It's speech 10, but today I intend breaking not one, but two rules. The first one is regarding inspiring people through a speech. I'm going to choose to make you uncomfortable and let the benighted situation inspire you into action. The second rule I'm about to break is not addressing every single member of the audience. I'm going to address our men friends here, way more than the female friends, because my topic today is about the battle of the sexes, specifically at work. Let's start with the situation that we see, especially in corporate America today. I used research from McKinsey & Company, arguably the world's leading consulting firm. And it doesn't quite matter the individual colors filled inside the females and the males that I'm showing here. The summary is, when you ask employees in America today questions around, did your gender get in the way of your promotion? Or allied questions like that, women will most obviously put their hand up and claim to be more affected by that than by men. If you were to ask employees questions around, do you think your company is doing enough to help gender diversity at work? Men will nod yes and say, of course, my company does a great job. But if you take the female employees aside, they will be like, no, there's a lot more that can be done. I can't live with this situation, and I'm hoping that none of us here can either. Why should you care about this? Going back to men, great. These are facts, you may believe them, but why should you care? Basically, because knowing each and every one of you here, I think you're decent, fair human beings that want to do the right thing. And it's also our fellow Toastmaster Melissa's birthday, so that's the best birthday gift you could give to her. But outside of that, you all have seen the Maslow's hierarchy of needs. It's just a pyramid that was built in 1943. We're focusing on the middle of the pyramid. 50% of your workforce consists of female employees. If you don't make them feel like part of the team, if you don't give them the credit, the rewards that they deserve for work that they do as well as us or better than us, you're sub-optimizing half your workforce. And that's not good for your team, that's not good for your business. So that's just a very fundamental reason grounded in basic human psychology why we need to up our game when it comes to being more inclusive with the genders. The second part I'd like to present is consistently identified leadership traits, again in corporate America, that successful, exceptional leaders have shown consistently. There's 16 traits that have been identified. And believe it or not, on 15 out of those 16, women leaders have outperformed male leaders, which means that the perspective that they bring to the table is different, enriched, and truly helps drive your business. So not taking advantage of women's leadership qualities is a great disservice to the company. So let's avoid that. Finally, when it comes to hard metrics, it has been found that companies that have at least 3 women on the board perform much better than their peers on at least 2 financial metrics. The return on equity and the earnings per share, by not just tiny amounts. These are pretty big amounts, 11% uptick and 45% uptick, which means more money for your bottom line. And guys, that means every one of us makes our bonuses and we can just go ahead and buy that Xbox we've been craving. I meant, take your mom and wife out to dinner for being important, influential women in your life. So this has hard financial metrics tied into the logic of gender diversity. Hopefully, now you're being spurred into action. What can I really do to jump on this bandwagon? So I have a couple of action item call-outs for all of us. The very first thing you can do is take a stand as an individual, as a team member. Agree that gender diversity is really required. If you see that gender diversity is not being welcomed, or certain members of the team are being left out of key conversations or plum assignments, please speak up. We as men owe it to this community, to this company, to speak up. If you don't take a stand, you can't expect the others to take a stand. So that's the very first thing I urge you to do. The second one is to continue to learn. All of us don't have all the answers. I certainly don't. But at least at this company, we have the employee resource group. We have men advocating real change. Plenty of resources uploaded online to train ourselves on these sensitive issues and go talk about these in a non-judgmental environment. So please take advantage of those. The third thing would be to share your stories. We all have personal and professional examples. I would certainly like to offer a few of mine that you need to share on bigger platforms without using judgment. And for other people, especially who share failure stories, use encouragement instead of criticism. Because everyone's on a learning journey here. No one in corporate America, at least, has figured this out. So bear with each other. A personal example from my life. My wife, who's an incredibly resourceful, brave, talented woman, came to me one day and said, I really feel like my career has stagnated and not having had a master's degree is holding me back. I think so. And it's only fair that more qualified people be given a chance. But I want to be among those qualified people, but I'm just in the rut of middle class America. I said, you know what, if that's truly what you believe in, get out of the workforce, go get your MBA, and I will support you. We don't have to go on fancy vacations for the next couple of years. Let's get to the grind, let's see you come back to the workforce more qualified. And she happily did it. She's right now in her core program at Baylor University's MBA program, and I'm happy for her. So don't forget, guys, that charity very often starts at home. So take that baby step. When it comes to work, there was a recent case where a requisition on our own team opened up, and we weren't, let's just say, a very diverse team. And we were looking for someone that knows the business but could also bring a customer-facing perspective, an analytical perspective to the requisition. And I went out and really batted hard for actually one of our Toastmaster members right here in the room, resulting in the team making her an offer. And I really pitched the value proposition that this person, who tends to go above and beyond her role, brings into Dell every single day. And I did this because I believed in the value she could add to the team. As a result, she's gotten an offer at a promoted grade, and we're hoping she joins us very soon. So those were some anecdotes from my own life, personal as well as professional, that I shared with you, and I encourage you to similarly bring examples from your life to the table. Lastly, mentor a woman. Every one of us knows female colleagues at work, some joining straight out of undergrad or graduate programs. Lead them a helping hand, show them you care. It means a lot. For someone that's in a 120,000 people strong company, just out of university, it might mean a lot to be handheld a little bit, to be shown the different things that she could explore within the company, to hear her insecurities, to hear her ambitions, and offer your insights if you as a male have been around in this industry or this company for a long time. You would be adding tremendous value to the company. And secondly, move beyond mentorship to sponsorship. Very often it is found that even women with mentors don't have the same career graphs, the same acceleration that women with sponsors do. So if you can, as an individual or as a hiring manager, be a sponsor. Go out and advertise high potential female candidates. Make sure that they get included culturally as well as professionally in all the key initiatives of the company. So if we take action starting today, I promise you that the battle of the sexes won't be a battle anymore. Thank you very much.